Yes, hello and welcome. It's our latest Confessions podcast from Radio 2. All the tawdry tales from this week, including a preposterous parable of pork chop proxy, a terrible tale of toy tank tarnishing, a cautionary confession concerning cat flap clumsiness, and a lurid legend of licorice leeches. Anyway, that's quite enough alliteration. They're pretty good, though, I think. 7 out of 10. Here it all comes. This is BBC Radio 2 with a drive time confession. Thank you very much indeed for yours. Plenty come in over the weekend. Send yours to confessions@bbc.co.uk. This one from Janet. Deadly is back from his weekend of debauchery. In fact, a week of debauchery. I don't know what you're up to, but you can hear it in his voice that he's been living
large.
I think so. Good for the voiceover, though, isn't it?
Yeah. Gets it down there.
Janet, thank you very much indeed for your tale. Dear Father Simon and the Forgiving Collective, I seek forgiveness from you for a mishap that occurred a number of years ago. My story begins in 2006, when my husband Dave came home from work to announce that the office had a new admin assistant called Pete. He'd been drafted in from head office in Newcastle and was currently staying on his own in a hotel until the house he was in the process of renting was ready. He could then arrange for his wife and daughter to move down to join him. My husband explained that he was settling in well and was, and I quote, his sort of person, which basically means into football, cricket and rugby and any other kind of sport you can mention.
Low-key.
Oh, and music as well. Yeah. I mentioned that we would have to invite Pete for tea one night as he was on his own. Well, a few days later, without any consultation with me, I must add, Dave arrived home from work with Pete. He said he'd asked Pete for tea and that they were going to watch the big game on TV later that evening.
We should have done that.
You sound like Sally.
Oh, do I? Sorry about that.
I greeted Pete and said he was very welcome. At that moment, though, I began to panic slightly. I had already begun preparing and cooking the meal, which was mashed potatoes, vegetables and pork chops. The trouble was, I only had two chops and now I had three people. Oh. I couldn't call to the shop as I knew Dave would question me and ask me where I was going, which could potentially embarrass our guest. And I couldn't cut up the meat as this would look as though we're a bit mean with our portions. And at this point, I hatched a plan that would be my downfall. And I would suggest that this next sentence is not one that anyone else has ever written.
Here we go.
Brilliant.
I decided to cut another pork chop out of a slice of bread.
What? I mean, obviously, that's what anyone would do.
It all looks the same.
I laid one of the chops on the bread and cut round the shape.
It's like what? Primary school stuff.
I thought that if I fried them all together, on looking at each one, they'd all look the same. And I would then serve myself the bread chop, and no one would know any different.
Clever.
Genius, I thought, said Janet. Well, I called Dave to set the table and plated up the meals. I positioned the plates on the kitchen counter with mine, with the bread chop, strategically placed on the left. Annie came into the kitchen and suggested we treat ourselves and our guest to a bottle of wine, even though it was a school night.
Hey, imagine that. Rock and roll.
Yeah.
I said I thought this was a good idea and went into the utility room to choose a nice bottle. Well, when I returned to the kitchen only moments later, Dave had done something that he'd never done before. He'd taken the plates into the dining room. I rushed through to see Dave and Pete already sat down with their meals in front of them and Dave saying, "Get stuck in, pal." I scanned my eyes quickly over the plates, hoping above hope that somehow Dave would have miraculously given the correct plate to me. I couldn't really tell on just glancing at them. I sat down and immediately cut into my chop. To my horror, it was made of real meat. I looked across at Dave, who was chatting away. I saw him cut into his piece of whatever it was, put it into his mouth. "Oh, these chops are so tender, cooked to perfection." And he congratulated me, and that meant... I looked over at Pete, who was just cutting into his chop.
No.
Made of bread. What a ludicrous idea.
Yes, take it off him, quick.
He took a bite, and I saw his expression suddenly change. He quickly took another bite, and he looked slightly bewildered and baffled, as though he'd walked into a very, very strange house. I could do no more but eat my own plate of food and hope that he just thought it was a new veggie type of meal or something. After it all finished, I took the plates away and asked Pete and Dave if they would like some ice cream for dessert, because I had a large tub in the freezer. Plenty for everybody, you know. Pete immediately declined.
Oh, no.
He said he had some emails to catch up on.
Yes, immediately.
And he left rather hastily, quite a long time before the football match even kicked off. Oh. A couple of weeks later, Dave told me he'd invited Pete for tea again, but he'd said no.
Funny, that.
So I need forgiveness from my beloved husband Dave for never coming clean about my little plan until now. This is why it went disastrously wrong, and this is why Pete left in a hurry and never ever came back. But obviously, most importantly, forgiveness from Pete for feeding him a slice of thin fried bread with his mash and two veg with a very nice Chianti, but that might not have helped really. As you can just, why can't, I would have thought either go out, it's fine, get another one, or chop it up and say you're. I don't know. There must have been some other way of doing it.
I think I might have told Dave.
We're not. It's not your turn. Not your turn. It's all. It's always.
You know,
Rebecca
I think
first.
That was my favourite ever confession.
Really?
The word, the phrase, the bread chop.
I know.
Hilarious.
I thought I'd cut another pork chop out of a slice of bread. Of course you did, Janet. Well
I
done.
I think I agree with Dudley. Actually, she should have told Dave, and then the mistake wouldn't have happened. You know, I mean, they're in it together, really. But I just think it's hilarious and just so funny that she couldn't say anything when she realised he had the bread chop. So I think because it was such a funny confession, I'm completely forgiving of you.
But a pork chop would be
thicker, wouldn't it?
So much
well?
Thicker than even a very thick
sliced bread.
Well, yes. Yes.
But perhaps the gravy or the jus, as we call it, would have sort of fleshed out the bread, wouldn't it? So it'd be slightly thicker, perhaps.
You think? This is your turn now, Dudley.
Oh,
you?
Is it now? Yes. Is it me? Well, I'd just like to thank Rebecca for being so kind. Unlike you, Matt. I would forgive you. I thought you were being terribly inventive. It was Dave who was the problem.
Dave, who's never carried plates through to the dining room.
Never, exactly. He took the plates in. He'd never done that before. And he invited, let's not forget, that he invited Pete without asking Janet at all. See?
Yeah.
See? So there we are. So I can't see how you can't forgive Janet.
Well,
Here we go.
Matt.
I think you have to applaud the invention of Janet in deciding, rather than doing what normal people would have done and basically not serving three chops, but yes. Deciding to serve this chop-shaped bread. Brilliant. Superb. I think I would have taken it a step further and said to Dave, in this house, we play sort of a Russian roulette version of have you got a real chop or have you got one made of bread? That's what we do in this house.
Good game.
It's considered good luck if you get the one made of bread.
Or just say you're not hungry.
So, yeah, exactly, yes. Oh, yeah, give him the chop, yes.
Give him the chop.
But I don't think she should have done that because it was, after all, her husband who brought this bloke round uninvited. So
yes.
I am definitely going to forgive for that reason.
It's a drive time confession, a hint of a warningette here for this confession. It's perfectly fine and perfectly decent. Sort of PG certificate might not go with food and drink consumption necessarily.
Another one.
Brilliant.
Just
don't eat. Fine.
It's the equivalent of saying, you know, it's got flash photography. It's just a thing. I'm just saying it is okay.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you very much indeed. Dear Father Simon and all that is holy, please forgive a childish misdemeanour which has until now gone unconfessed and unforgiven. Who's this from, Matt? Just give us a name.
Bill.
It's from Bill. Thank you, Bill. My dad is great at making things with wood. When we were young, he would make toys for our Action Men figures that were quite often better than the store-bought alternatives. One such toy that he lovingly made for my brother was a tank. Now, this, I have to tell you, was no ordinary tank. Measuring about 3 feet long and 1.5 feet wide, this is a substantial beast. The greatest thing about the tank is that it had a turret which the Action Man could sit in. It was a thing of beauty. Smooth running tracks, beautifully painted, but mainly it had this turret with a seat and a gun and everything. I have to admit, I was a tiny bit jealous of my older brother Sean's heavy machinery. There was, therefore, an unfortunate incident when it comes to this tank, for which I must now confess. Being a naughty little soldier on the day in question, I had been banished to my room. "You don't come out of that room until we say so, not for anything," shouted my mum. "Is that clear? You stay in there, all right?" That's my mum voice. My cross mum voice.
Okay.
Fairly similar
Very
to my
good.
Cross dad voice.
Yes.
Now, I can't remember, says Bill, what it was, as being in trouble was quite a common occurrence for me, as I might have mentioned, a young naughty soldier. After my tears of bravery subsided, I examined my surroundings. I was, of course, in the room I shared with my brother Sean. It was at this point that I noticed my brother's tank, securely placed out of harm's reach on top of his wardrobe. Using the extreme bravery that only a naughty soldier could muster, I built a tank extraction ramp out of cushions. And soon I was playing quite happily with Sean's tank. Being banished wasn't so bad after all, I thought. Anyway, it was during this state of innocent childhood happiness that nature began to call. Frankly, I needed to wee. Now, the dilemma was clear. I needed to go to the loo, but I couldn't leave the room. My mum, as I think I've just made clear, had made her views crystal clear. I had to stay put, whatever. I needed to be inventive, clearly. So all things considered, I decided that the best way to survive would be to use the tank turret as a urinal.
There you go.
Now, having filled it halfway, I now had another dilemma. How to get it out of the turret. It was at this point that my dad walked in, and he was about to say something and then noticed the tank. "You're not playing with that," he said, and scooped it up, placing it back on top of the wardrobe. A slight sloshing noise could be heard, but Dad didn't notice. I was holding my breath, but it was now out of sight and out of mind. For a few weeks, Sean didn't play with his tank until one rainy Saturday when he asked Dad to get it down for him. Dad, strong as he was, lifted it down. And as he laid it to the deck, he noticed some rusty-looking fluid in the turret. "That's odd. I don't think we have a leak." At which point he dipped his finger and tasted.
No.
And my brother, being a daddy's boy, did the same. And the conclusion was obvious. "You know, I think we've got a leak." I obviously was thinking, "That's precisely what you've got."
"Yep."
"I'll go into the loft," says Dad. And for a few days, my dad tried to find the mysterious leak and yet found nothing. And so today, Dad and Sean, I must confess... that it wasn't a leak that you tasted, although it was in some strange way. And I never said anything at the time, so now it would appear that I should. Please forgive me. Says Bill, "See, it's got a tank in it, and it involves being banished to the room, and it allowed me to act being..." It was just a shouty voice. Anyway, Sister Rebecca now speaks on tonight's confession. Thanks for the memory.
Okay, who would taste the foul-looking liquid? Surely you would just smell it or just look at it and think, that could be a leak. It could be something equally disgusting.
Well, it was just, you know,
I mean,
you have to
put your finger in it, sorry?
Use
really?
All your senses.
Do you
use all your senses.
Does anyone really do that? So I think that that was a bit silly of the dad. But I also think that Bill took his mother a bit too literally when she said, "Don't come out on any account," because I'm sure she would have understood if he really did need.
Well, I think as we've learnt in the last few days, some children take things literally.
Well, yeah, that's so true. But I think he shouldn't have done. And I don't think it was very nice of him to wee in the brother's turret. So I'm not going to forgive.
Again, a sentence that probably hasn't ever been said
no.
on the radio.
Well,
and probably
first.
Won't be said again.
You have to applaud Bill, I think, for the being able to come up with a ramp of cushions that goes up to the top of a wardrobe. That's quite a lot of cushions.
In a tank extraction thing.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, so I'm impressed by that. And also, if they thought it was a leak from the roof or from the loft, then there would have been evidence on the ceiling. So one has to look at Bill's dad there and very much point the finger at him for not being able to work out the difference between what was clearly in the turret and what he thought was in the turret. So on that basis, I am going to forgive.
I think you're going to like this from Heather, tonight's confession, drive time confession. Gather around, everybody. Heather, thank you very much indeed. Dear Father Simon and the Forgiving Few, I just want to start by saying I love your show. Listen to it every day, and I love the confession slot.
Brilliant.
Right, well, forgiven then. I write to ask forgiveness from you beautiful people for a sad episode that happened back in 1999 when I was 24. It all started after a very rowdy night out at a friend's hen party in Chester. It ended up by being a very late night. I got home after 4 a.m. Taxi dropped me off. At the time, I lived alone in a lovely semi-detached house in an equally lovely and quiet cul-de-sac in North Wales. I had two cats, Chubby and Charlie. Real names, haven't changed those. I tried to locate my front keys after I'd been dropped off in my little handbag, but I couldn't find them anywhere. I was effectively locked out of my house. Now, the last time I managed to lock myself out, I got into the back garden, I knelt down and I put a small broomstick through the cat flap and knocked the back key door out of the lock. I put my hand through the cat flap and got the key. That's how I did it last time. So on this fateful night, or early morning as it was, I thought I could do the same. My first obstacle was the back gate, which I'd forgotten I had locked earlier the previous day. So I climbed and stumbled onto the bonnet of my first ever company car in my high heels, launched myself over the gate into the back garden. Luckily, I landed on the soft lawn and was relieved I was alone, as my short skirt had ended up revealing a little bit too much that was decent. This is a relevant point, by the way. I then found my small broom and went about to trying to get my little trick going and dislodging the back door key through the cat flap. Well, for some reason, I couldn't seem to keep the broom straight whilst reaching through the cat flap, and I couldn't remember if I'd even left the back door key in the lock in the first place. So I thought it'd be a good idea if I could just see if the key was in the lock. So I had a tipsy brainwave to put my head into the cat flap, which seemed more than big enough, frankly, to accommodate my head. And then if I could just see the key was in the lock, then I could carry on with my attempt to knock it out of the lock. But it didn't quite go according to plan. I knelt down and proceeded to put my head through the cat flap quite easily, whilst giggling to myself and thinking, I'm so glad that no one can see what I'm doing. To my delight, the key was in the back door lock, which was a relief. So I then went to remove my head back out of the cat flap. And guess what? My ears seemed to have got stuck, so I could not get my head back out. I tried again by planting my hands firmly on the cold concrete and tried and pushed and heaved, but to no avail. So as you can imagine, I started to sober up pretty quickly and started to panic. Now, I live alone, so I couldn't shout for anyone to come and help, and it was 4:30 in the morning, and my neighbour is elderly and deaf. So after trying and trying again to dislodge my head, I started shouting help as loud as I possibly could and praying and hoping that someone in my very quiet and well-to-do cul-de-sac would hear my frantic shouts. In the meantime, my cats had got very distressed and kept pushing my face from the inside to try and get out, much to my annoyance. After what seemed like a very long time, I heard someone climbing over my gate, and I just hoped it would be a friendly neighbour. But to my complete embarrassment and shock, it was the local policeman. Apparently one of the neighbours had called the police, hearing my shouting and a bit of a commotion. The policeman climbed over the fence without jumping on the bonnet of my car, which I had done. Now, you need to know I had a bench next to my back door, and all I could hear was a muffled noise which sounded to me like crying. The policeman had to literally sit down on my bench as he couldn't stop laughing. After shouting to him through the cat flap, he understood what I had done, so went into my handbag to double-check my front door keys were actually lost. Would you believe it? They were there all the time. Oh, no. I was even more mortified at this point, as he must have thought I was even more stupid than I looked. So this young, and I have to say quite attractive, policeman let himself in through my front door, though I could say you wouldn't know this at the time. Anyway, let himself in through the front door, let my cats out, and came and sat on the floor in my kitchen to talk it all through with me and to find out how I'd got into this state. He really was very nice, considering what a fool I'd made of myself, and he tried everything to coax my ears flat back against my head so I could get my head out of this wretched cat flap. He tried washing up liquid, he tried face cream from the bathroom, and even olive oil, but nothing was working. So he looked at me with a big smile on his face and said, I'm going to have to call the fire brigade.
Hey!
So this policeman then called the local fire station and explained the situation, and I could tell he was trying so hard not to laugh, and I heard him say, no, the full team did not have to come out and explain the nature of the call. Just when I thought it couldn't get any worse, a fire engine roars out with lights flashing, filling the small cul-de-sac at 6 a.m. with the whole fire station, who'd turned up as they couldn't believe what the fireman had said. By this time, I was mortified beyond anything you can possibly imagine. The kind and, again, just my luck, attractive fireman went into my bedroom and brought down a quilt to hide my modesty. My inadequate skirt was stressing them out, and they had to keep chatting to me to calm me down. Anyway, to be honest, they were all lovely, even though they were trying so hard to stifle their laughter. So next up came a large saw. The plan was to cut a larger hole in my wooden back door and then a smaller saw to dislodge the cat flap. So the saw started to work, with one fireman cutting a hole around me and the other fireman in the back garden holding the duvet discreetly around my waist. You can imagine this is a delicate operation. So, right. So all I can hear is this saw cutting into my beautiful back door, and it then got caught on something, maybe a knot in the wood. The saw jumps sideways and knocks the side of my head.
Oh, my.
I saw stars, though I do think the alcohol helped numb the pain. And just when you think it couldn't get any worse, the police decided they had to call an ambulance to attend. So it went from me being alone, drunk and stuck in a cat flap, to a police car and a fire engine and now an ambulance outside my house. The fireman managed to cut a hole in my back door, get me off my knees, but I was then carried into the waiting ambulance with a now bloody plastic cat flap, that's the cat flap that is bloody, still attached to my head. I was protesting that I was fine and didn't want to go to hospital, but they insisted. So, again, just when you think it can't get any worse, I'm wheeled into my local A&E on a stretcher with a plastic cat flap around my neck, which was eventually removed by a bemused consultant at the hospital who sent me home with a packet of paracetamol for my headache, which was caused more by my shame and a hangover. There are no words, really, to describe how embarrassing the whole experience has been, and all I wanted to do was to crawl into bed to hide under my duvet forever. But the policeman, who originally responded to my call for help, popped round to make sure I was okay. She adds, euphemistically. Anyway, my back door was secured. So I'd like to seek forgiveness to all my unfortunate neighbours who were all woken up by my drunken shouts for help at 4 a.m. on a quiet Sunday morning and then having the street filled with all the emergency services in turn. Also forgiveness from my then employer when I told him I had no idea how two large scratches appeared on the bonnet of my new company car. And forgiveness to my cats, who will never understand why they will... the current cats, that is, who will never understand why they will not get a cat flap fitted into the back door. As you can imagine, I was the talk of my street for a very long time. I became known as the Cat Flap Woman. And from that morning onwards, I put my house up for sale and I moved to another town. So I love your show and would love it if this was included in your show. So Heather, we've changed the name, though the names of the cats are genuine, tells us an interesting story, which you can understand, I think, how she was very, very embarrassed. It was just an innocent hen night and ended up A&E, all the emergency services. What do you say?
Bit extreme to sell her house, don't you think? I mean, the neighbours didn't see her in her...
Well, they did.
Do you think they did?
Yes. Unbelievably, I shortened the story.
Right,
really?
Okay. Some lovely images came to mind during that, not least the cat flap around her neck as she was on the stretcher going to hospital. I just love that story. It's fantastic.
And the policeman arriving with this woman with her head through the door.
And trying to, you know, rub olive oil on her ears and stuff. That's just great. It's worse than the toe in the tap, isn't it, when you get stories about getting your toe caught in the tap during your bath time. I think, it's a great story, so I'm going to forgive.
What do you say, Brother Matt?
What a story that is. Absolutely superb. But I would say you've now ruined the emergency services for that story, because they live for that. They live for the one call that comes in of, we've got a young lady caught in a cat flap, care to come and get her out.
That would be nice. Whole station.
Yes, I'll go. They'll never get a call like that again, and they'll all have been regaling themselves with that story for a while. So I am definitely going to forgive. What a superb story!
And I was going to ask for more for cat flap confession, but I suspect that's the ultimate cat flap confession.
You'll do well to beat that, yeah.
Confession time tonight. By the way, we welcome novice Nigel back into our collective. So, frankly, who knows what's going
to
happen?
Delighted to be here, Abbot Mayo.
Thank you. I'm Father Mayo, by the way.
I know. I've just promoted you. You deserve it. You've been a father.
Is an abbot higher than a father?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Anyway, now, this comes from Mavis, which I suspect is changed. Anyway, Mavis, thank you very much indeed. My dear vicar, choir mistress and organ grinder.
Hello.
While squeezing Bovril onto my toes this morning, I had an almighty flashback of a revolting misdemeanour for which I should certainly seek forgiveness, although for which I'm not remotely sorry. The year was around 2000, and at that time, my then partner, boyfriend, lover and cheat were enjoying a great deal of paragliding in the mountains of Spain. Brilliant fun, stupidly dangerous, and the proverbial accident waiting to happen. I'm going to call him William. And William and I had been having this fun for a jolly long time, but one summer, while I was in England and he was in Spain, flying his nylon kite with a giant hairdryer harnessed to his back, the inevitable happened. The wind grabbed him, threw him against the rocks, and he plunged into the valley, with no mobile phone to call for help. However, armed with a whistle and an LED flashing dog collar, the guardia somehow found and rescued him and blue-lighted him to hospital with nothing more serious than a broken leg and a very bruised pride. An intriguing start to the story, I'm sure you'll agree. After 3 weeks in the Spanish hospital with fag ends and cola cans on the floor, whole families sleeping next to patients' beds and the wound doused in iodine every 10 minutes, the surgeons decided he'd make a full recovery, so it was okay to be flown back to the UK, to an amazing hospital, and if anyone can fix you up, this hospital certainly can. Several weeks were spent there, and many operations and skin grafts and other really vile things, which, because it's tea time, I will leave out. I went in to visit one evening to be greeted with a large jar on his bedside table. A large jar full of leeches. Yes, it's leeches, says Mavis. Apparently, they use the old-fashioned methods and they get great results. Why are you looking so pained and puzzled?
I'm just surprised. But
sorry, is this still in the original hospital?
No, they're back in the UK now.
16th century, apparently.
Right. No, leeches.
They've left Spain. Okay, they're now back in the UK.
Okay, got it.
I've got the name of the hospital. We just take the name of the hospital out.
Okay, fine.
Right. So they got a big jar of leeches. They use the old-fashioned methods. They get great results. The nurse comes in with a pair of tweezers. Picks up a leech, puts it onto the wound, and when it's full, falls off, and is then dispatched to the leech home in the sky. We were warned to keep the lid on the jar, as they like to wander off. Now, as a consequence of all the drugs being pumped into William, he was finding it difficult to go to the loo, and so I was taking licorice in every couple of days just to help things. And one evening, I looked at the box of licorice.
Oh, no.
I like him.
Salted. And I had a thought. Personally, I hate the stuff, but I put a piece of it into my mouth and chewed, and I spat it out and I moulded it into the shape of an unfed leech. I then chewed several more pieces and placed and stuck them strategically around his bay on the ward. I stuck them on the walls, got one on the ceiling lamp, one on the curtain rail, anywhere I could reach. When the next nurse came in to remove the full leech from his wound and replace with an unfed one, I said, "Do they often just wander off like that? Look, they move so quickly, it's quite astonishing, isn't it?" Her startled eyes jumped from leech to licorice leech. "They've escaped!" she yelled. With William hiding under the covers, suppressing his hysterics with a coughing fit, and the rest of the ward doing likewise, though joining in with, "Leeches, they're everywhere, run!" The nurse called for reinforcements and more tweezers to collect these little blighters, by which time I was laughing so much I had to leave. Ward sister was called in and had never seen anything like it in her life. "Get these collected and destroyed immediately!" So clearly, we've caused a lot of trouble. And so, therefore, forgiveness is asked. Not for actually doing it, because it was a genuinely very funny thing and seriously cheered up all the other patients who were very clearly in on it. But forgiveness, obviously, from the junior nurse, the then junior nurse, who suffered the wrath of not only sister, but matron. Yes, they still have matron there, who was berated severely in front of the whole ward for not having replaced the lid securely, and who, because of her lowly status, was not allowed to answer back and say, "Actually, the leeches were, in fact, a licorice." I might try this out, actually. In my defence, says Mavis, once the bigwigs had left the ward, I collected all the leeches that I'd made and I wiped down every surface with that hand gel in the pump at the bottom of the bed, the stuff that matron didn't use. Can you please find it in your hearts to forgive a truly penitent sinner? One can but try. And you see, Mavis says, "I'm a truly penitent sinner," but right at the beginning she said she's not remotely sorry. So it sounds like
contradictory messages.
Slightly contradictory. I like the way that she put in at the end, "I wiped it all down afterwards and I used hand gel and everything else," almost preempting the kind of stuff and nonsense that you're going to say. Anyway, Sister Rebecca...
So do they really use leeches in hospitals? I didn't know that. Yeah. That's a big surprise.
Well, the time of this...
No, they still do.
It's the year 2000.
Okay. I thought that Mavis was going to put a leech in the licorice box and then make her husband, William, eat it by mistake, thinking it was a piece of licorice.
I don't think we'd have got that part.
I
think...
I was actually pleasantly surprised by the fact it was just licorice stuck on the ceiling, which she pretended to be leeches.
Causing panic.
I thought it was really funny, and the patients were in on it, so it's fine, and you're completely forgiven.
By the same, if you put a leech in your mouth, I think that's going to be a really daft thing to do, and that wouldn't have been approved, I don't think so. Yes, novice Nigel.
They are coming back, leeches. I think tapeworms. I wonder about those as well, because Victorian women used to swallow the larvae of tapeworms. I'm not suggesting you do that, but then kill them off a bathtub gym. But what would you replicate? Would it be a long piece of chewing gum? Something like that. If you imagine what a tapeworm looks like.
What do you mean they're coming back, leeches?
No, in hospital.
Oh, I see.
Are you talking about that?
Well, yes, because...
On with the subject.
Tapeworms could be. Right. No. Anyway, also, what was interesting earlier on, Mavis mentioned William Hanglide, all this cheat...
Yeah, remember exactly.
That? So there's partner, boyfriend, lover, cheat.
Cheat, yeah. So there you go. And the fact, but I thought you're going to start off, he pegged it when he'd fallen into the valley, maybe just had a broken leg. Very funny story. Everyone was in on it. Poor, and I'm sure the nurse at the time who was suffering will have told the story from a very funny perspective since. So at Mavis 2000, that's the year that she was doing it, is forgiven.
Thank you very much indeed, Matthew.
Yeah, I don't have a lot of sympathy for this nurse that couldn't tell the difference between licorice and a leech. I mean, you know, fair enough, from a distance, maybe they look very similar. But I think when you get up close and actually pick it up...
Taste it.
And put it in your mouth.
Well, no, I'm not suggesting, obviously, you put it in your... But obviously, when you pick it up, you go, hang on, this is just a
You're
sticky sweet.
You're not going to pick up a leech.
This isn't... Well, what else do you do with it, then?
Get tweezers.
Well, all right, when you get your tweezers and you go, hang on, this isn't a leech at all. She works with leeches, but apparently can't tell the difference between them and a licorice allsort. And
no,
for
it wasn't,
that...
No, you see, it wasn't...
A licorice allsort, I've decided it was licorice allsort. It helps my argument if we say it was a licorice allsort. And so for that reason, I am going to forgive.
Those were this week's confessions. Who did you forgive? And then send in your shadowy secret, please, with a few lines. Confessions at bbc.co.uk is where you send it. Thank you very much indeed for listening. Don't forget the weekly Mayo, available to download now and every Thursday. Thank you.